This is episode 40 of the BioBalance Healthcast. I'm Dr. Kathy Maupin.
And I'm Brett Newcomb. And today we're talking about the information and decision matrix for determining whether or not you are a candidate for hormone replacement therapy. And Dr. Maupin has come up with what she calls a baker's dozen rules that you should think about, get information about, and be able to respond to in helping you make the decision. Mm-hmm. So, Kathy, let's talk about these rules. Where do they start?
They start with finding a doctor. I mean, I can't take care of everybody.
Right.
So finding a doctor who actually has a good handle on hormones, who has been doing it longer than 6 months, who has experience doing this. And it's generally a good idea to find a doctor. An OBGYN for women is the hormone doctor, mm-hmm. not endocrinologists. They take care of other things, diabetes and thyroid and pituitary problems. But in general, OBGYNs do the infertility, which is hormones. And we also do postmenopausal hormone replacement. It's just that we haven't been trained to do bioidentical hormones, and we haven't been trained to really look at the labs properly. So this is how to choose, with an educated mind, your doctor.
Yeah, because what you've been saying through all of these podcasts that we've been doing is that you're not attacking or criticizing anybody's doctor or any doctor's training. Mm-hmm. What you're saying is that this is an evolving specialty that is making use of new information that is the derivative product of new research that's been done that a lot of doctors have not, because they are already in practice, taken the time to develop a specialty in. And you have done that, and you've developed that specialty. And so what you're trying to do is say to people, this is what I've learned, this is what I know, ask your doctor if they know about this. And if they don't know about this, then these are the things that you need to do so that you can make a good decision.
And find a doctor who does understand this. I mean, one of the biggest issues is that patients come to me and they say, I showed this lab that you say shows that I need hormones to my internist or to my OBGYN, and they said, you're fine. You don't need hormones. Well, part of that is that lab tests don't show the young normal levels. They only show the big span of hormones, whether you're menopausal or you're premenopausal. They give a huge range and they say, oh, that's normal.
So they take a statistical average of all the people that have the labs run. Right. They don't do it against an age cohort, and they don't do it against young, healthy standard.
That's right. And sometimes they do it by an age standpoint, and that means if you're menopausal and you have no estradiol and your FSH, which gives you hot flashes, is off the charts, they say that's normal because you're menopausal.
Yeah, you should be that way. You're getting old.
But that's not, we don't believe that. We don't believe that you should be that way.
Well,
we believe you should have the
it's not a matter of
quality
belief.
Of
you
life.
You have proof that that's not
well,
true anymore.
That's true.
Your,
I mean,
your practice is a foundation for thousands of clients that no longer have those issues because you don't believe that. You know that.
I know. Well, I know that. And
exactly.
I have, and I strive to bring my patients to young, healthy normals. Mm-hmm. However, I have to write in my normals on the lab because the lab won't give me the proper, even I've talked to all of them, won't give me the proper normals on these. So you have to ask your doctor if this is young, healthy.
Okay, I want to keep you in order here because for the students who follow along at home, we've already covered three of the dozen rules.
Okay, all right, go through the rules.
The first one is select the best doctor for the job.
Yeah.
Interview your doctor, find out what your doctor knows, see if they are sensitive to, aware of, informed about these new changes in medicine. Two, hormone results. Test results should always be compared against young, healthy normals, not against a large database of everybody that's ever taken a test. Mm-hmm. Three, doctors should look at lab values and patient history symptoms at the same time. So when you say that, what do you mean by that?
I mean, I always get lab tests before a patient comes in, review it before I even bring them in. Then I sit down with the patient. I don't send them their lab ahead of time because they're going to look at it and not be able to interpret it. I sit down with the patient, go over every part of their lab, and make sure they understand what the good things are. Like if their cholesterol is great, I'm going to tell them that. I'm going to reassure them on the good things, the things that they're afraid of, and reassure them that that's not a risk. And I'm also going to tell them that, you know, what each test means, especially in the hormone levels, and what we have to do.
So you're looking at the whole person, the whole spectrum of information that's available
yes.
about them. You're not just looking at the lab test. You're not just looking at the medical charts. You are talking to them about the way that they live and the way that they feel and what their history is, and you're manipulating all of that data to get an accurate picture mm-hmm. of their symptomology mm-hmm. and their needs.
Right, and I'm making sure that I understand all their medical illnesses and their medications, because some of these things affect your hormones and your symptoms. So when I sit down with somebody for 45 minutes, we put it all together and make a treatment plan. You should not leave a doctor's office without a treatment plan. They should have a plan for you.
So part of what I understand then is that sometimes it's hard to know which comes first, the chicken or the egg, because these factors cross-reference one another. And so sometimes mm-hmm. you're talking about thyroid issues, sometimes you're talking about obesity issues, mm-hmm. sometimes you're talking about depression, mm-hmm. Lethargy, mental acuity, all of those things which may or may not have a reflection in a lab test, a blood test.
Right, right.
So
some of it is just symptoms.
So you need to know the blood test parts, the medical test parts, but mm-hmm. also you need to know what the client has to say about how they present, how they feel, what mm-hmm. their body's telling them and telling you.
If you go to our website, mm-hmm. there's a questionnaire, and the questionnaire has most of the symptoms that my patients have when they have hormonal imbalances. And so I've already delineated all of those symptoms, and that's what makes them realize whether they need me or not.
Yeah, the warning cues are the trigger. So if you see these five things, you need to talk to somebody and get more information.
Right, right, okay. And they can send that in, and we'll send them a lab sheet.
And by the way, if you're following along at home, we will post these dozen rules at the end. There'll be a slide that you can see so that you don't have to worry about catching them as we go through them. When you have a conversation with a prospective client, I mean, in the beginning of the process of deciding to treat somebody, or for somebody to decide that your treatment is what they want, mm-hmm. you order labs.
Yes.
And one of the frustrations that you've articulated to me has to do with this next rule. And the next general medical rule of thumb is always follow the instructions given by the doctor before getting a blood test.
True.
Can you talk a little bit about that and what some of the frustrations that you and other doctors experience mm-hmm. are around that topic?
You can end up, if you don't follow the instructions, getting a treatment for a disease you don't really have, because your doctor told you to either fast mm-hmm. or go at 8 a.m. in the morning, or for a PSA test, you have to refrain from having sex for 48 to 72 hours.
So I've never been told that.
And that's on our handout when we send you the lab sheet. That's on the handout for the men.
Okay.
So it's written. And if you don't have that, your PSA goes up if you've had sex, or if you've had a prostate exam. So you could be treated for prostate issues, prostate pre-cancer or cancer, go through painful biopsies just because of that.
You know, I have to tell you, I have trouble telling the guys in the locker room that my doctor's a gynecologist.
I know.
Don't think about going to gynecologists.
I know, but I didn't do a pelvic on you, so that's
no, that's
okay.
True. But what you're saying is that doctors, that gynecologists are the most likely specialty to have this information.
Right.
And so if men are suffering from hormone imbalances, mm-hmm. they're going to need most likely to go to a gynecologist and not to an endocrinologist or a urologist mm-hmm. for this information.
Right. I mean, in some cities, maybe that's true, but in St. Louis, I've gone to my friends who are urologists, and they're like, ugh, you take care of it. Seriously. I mean, they'll give them some Viagra or something, but they don't want to deal with that. They're surgeons.
Okay.
And that's the issue.
So general medical rule of thumb, always follow the instructions. There may be issues or complications that occur that cause improper treatment, painful treatment, unnecessary treatment.
Or another test. You might have to have a test drawn again.
Or more expense. That's right. Mm-hmm. So follow your directions. And we always say that to students, and they never, almost never do. The fifth thing that you wanted to make a point about, or the fifth rule, is that hormone replacement test results will cause some test interpreters to say that your levels are too high.
Right.
Does that mean after you've already taken?
Yes.
Okay.
That after you've been treated mm-hmm. with the proper amount of hormones, mm-hmm. okay, then for a woman, her estradiol should come back into the physiologic range between 60 and 350, which is the range that we have when we're cycling. So we should go back to premenopausal levels. But sometimes doctors look at this and say, what's wrong with you? You know, you're too high. You should have the lowest possible level that takes away some of your symptoms. I don't understand that. I don't give the lowest possible level of insulin.
Yeah.
That's going to keep you from having, you know, a hyperglycemic coma. I mean, I give you what you should have in insulin.
I think my wife was saying to me just the other day, you know, I don't think I'm in my proper physiologic range.
And yeah, I bet she was.
She talks that
but
way.
But it's the doctor looking at it, and they scare my patients. They say, oh, your estrogen's too high, it's 100, and you're menopausal. Well, it's not abnormal. That's perfect. That's exactly where we feel good and where we felt good when we were 35.
And that goes back to the point that you're making, that this is an evolving medical specialty that has new training and new information, mm-hmm. that doctors who've been practicing for a long time and haven't chosen to pursue this line of study mm-hmm. don't have that information.
Some of it's in the GYN journals, uh-huh. but our colleges, the people that run OBGYNs and every other specialty, tell us guidelines, and the guidelines is less is more. That's not good in terms of hormones. Mm-hmm. You don't feel normal if you have low levels of hormones. Why bother?
So the goal isn't a low level maintenance dosage.
Right.
The goal is the proper dosage to restore what mm-hmm. normal levels were when you were young mm-hmm. and healthy.
Right.
So for everybody, this can be a little different.
Mm-hmm.
Age factors, weight factors, general health condition mm-hmm. factors, other illnesses, mm-hmm. Patient history. Which is why you have the conversation and the labs.
I have a conversation with them before and after.
Right.
We sit down and go, okay, so what's not better? Here
yes.
are your labs. What should we do about that? So
okay.
that's how we manage it.
Then rule number six, prior to treatment, before the decision is made and they're in the questioning phase, says it's critical to compare testosterone levels against young, healthy, normal. You've already said that as a general mm-hmm. rule. Why do you delineate testosterone levels out for extra emphasis?
Because testosterone is something that we don't have a good test mm-hmm. to do total and free testosterone on women.
Okay, so tell us what you mean by free testosterone.
Free testosterone means that's the only part that really matters. That's the part, that's the testosterone that's working in your body.
It's not
bound to a protein.
Okay.
So if it's free to work, it crosses the blood-brain barrier, goes to your brain, that goes to every part of your body, every cell in your body. If it's bound, it's just like storage. When you have a hormone, it's stored in your blood, but it's attached to a protein that inactivates its activity. So it doesn't matter what your total testosterone is. It matters what your free testosterone is.
So if it's attached to a protein, it's like a gun that's on safety. It's not going to fire. It's not
right.
going to do its job.
Absolutely.
If it's a free testosterone, then it's a chemical messenger that races around the body system and goes where it's supposed to go, and it gives cell systems or organ systems information.
It's able to attach to the cells, right.
Yes, okay.
So testosterone in young women, total should be over 30, that's mm-hmm. normal, mm-hmm. and free should be over 10. So I see a lot of people that because the lab test says it's in range, and their doctors don't really know what the normal is for young, healthy, or may not get it, then they think they're normal, but they clearly have every sign of testosterone deficiency. So,
well, and testosterone is the critical issue. If for people that have been tracking other podcasts or some of the articles that you've written, what you identify is that the cascade of age deterioration effects that occur begins or seems to begin mm-hmm. with the trigger of decreased testosterone.
And that's why I'm here, because no one really embraces that like uh-huh. like I do. And I want other people to get their testosterone back. It's critical for me to have that.
So if you get your testosterone normals back, then mm-hmm. all these other things can fall into place.
That's right.
All right. If you have questions about this podcast or comments that you would like to make, you can email us at podcast@biobalancehealth.com. You can read my blog at brettnewcomb.com.
And if you'd like to know more about BioBalance Health or bioidentical hormones, visit our website, biobalancehealth.com, or call my office, 314-993-0963.
And if you want to hear the other six rules, tune in for next week's podcast. Thank you.